And then all at once, the noise was swallowed up entirely. The sea silent. Like my old Uncle Samuel, who'd rage bloody murder and then disappear for days. The ship sailed like my Aunt Lizzie's bedsheets on the line, swaying in the breeze. My first steps ashore are sticky ones. The wet clay soil latches onto my black boots, willing to travel anywhere else for dear life. Dear life, a metaphor I missed then. Oh, it is a marshy peninsula. Everything is wet. The ship was soaked early on, so I've been sitting, sleeping, standing in seawater for 4.5 months. My fingertips look like tiny old trees. Green, dark and leafy, I imagine what's behind the trees, beyond the bush. My eyes squinting, looking hard to catch something, someone beneath my lashes. Eyes, 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 wide open now. Any looking back at me? Here, long before me, long before all of us. Hello? My new horizon seems limitless, but there is work to be done. The dogs are let loose from the ship and run in circles, rolling in the mud and muck. So happy the ground has stopped moving beneath their paws. Joyously grateful. Mistress Forrest leads the way to the fort, her grand skirts dragging in the mud and muck. I follow as swiftly as I can, carrying her necessaries. I don't have any necessaries. As a servant, one's not really permitted any. On the journey, Mistress Forrest made Master Forrest tell her over and over again what she could expect at the fort. She wanted to visualize it, plan where we'd eat, how we'd sleep. I wondered if it would live up to her expectations, to her imaginations. The men came before us, built up these walls of mud and stud. We were to live within these timber frames. As Master Forrest trekked back and forth to the ship, lugging supplies and helping the other men, Mistress Forrest carried a weight of her own. Pacing the rooms of the fort, she talked to herself. I followed at a safe distance. This won't do! Oh, oh! Perhaps, but what of this? Oh! Oh! And this? Oh! No! 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 Oh, heavens! Eventually, Master Forrest joined the conversation, and we all felt a good deal better about that. A madwoman is the last thing any colonist wants. I set about starting a fire. A cup of tea can cure anything, can't it? The next morning, a tour. Bulwark, bulwark, bulwark. The land had been chosen because it was deemed favorable for defensive purposes. Who we needed protecting from, I couldn't be sure. The horizon remained unbroken. Oh. The fort between. The beginnings of a church. Barracks and burial ground. And at the far side of the fort, what they called the factory, to be used as a brewery, a trading post, and an escape for the men. From the women, I assumed. And beyond the walls, the forest, animals, others. Within the walls, there were about 130 of us, and all anyone had said for the first 2 months since we landed on this rock was, "Wait until the next ship arrives, then we'll have provisions aplenty." with chickens and beef and fruit and vegetables and seeds for growing more?
Yes, dear.
Our journey hadn't been the smoothest. We'd lost much of what we'd aimed to bring. We spent hours planning the menu we would have when the next ship finally arrived. The second ship arrives, but more than doubles our numbers, even though they lost all of their animals to illness and half of their passengers too. The rest of them had eaten most of the rations on board, so there were just scraps remaining. Not the bounteous feast we'd all been hoping for. Some took the news better than others.
Wipe your face and move on, love.
Master Forrest's jowls flapped like the flag he brooded upon our arrival. I don't know why we thought the other ships would be any different than our own. The initial hope that the land would provide agricultural gains was fading quickly. It was swampy and isolated and plagued by mosquitoes. Despite the lessening of food, the constraints of the island allowed for infinite imaginings and boundless possibilities. Children again, we made our own worlds, our own games, our own lives. And with so few of us, and surely less women than men, we got to know one another, made friends with the friendliest creatures of this place. The bird songs are different here. The wolves howl in a lower key. The fish swim faster, dive deeper. They're not used to having so much company. But we also got to work. It is not easy here, although I know it could be harder, much. For those who don't, who've had it easier than I, they are struggling. Mistress Forrest cries a lot. Master Forrest grumbles, "Wipe your face and move on, love." Mistress Forrest wipes her face. Oh! Master Forrest moves on. Oh! When one is in pursuit of a moment of peace, an unquiet man is an inevitability! Response to the hunger, though. I think of Miss Claire, who fancied Mr. Fred a noble son for nearly the whole of her existence, but she'd been forced from him and into this new place. The entire journey here, she moped and cried, and when we finally arrived ashore, her crying turned to a whimper. I thought that meant she was getting better, but after 3 months here, her whimper had grown into a kind of low, constant whine, a kind of despairing hum. It seemed there were only two possibilities for such a sound. Either it would regress into the pit of her stomach, hollowing her out as it tunneled down deep, cracking her in two, or it would widen into an earth-shattering wail, drowning the world in her grief. and her along with it. Either way, she'd be destroyed. Loving someone hardly seemed worth the outcome. With the definitive lack of food, different camps were set up. Those determined to find it by any means, hunting, foraging, creating, and those who waited, the sad ones, the ones who needed saving. They were almost adamantly hopeless. At night, I take my leave. By the water's edge, I watch a beaver build a dam in the dark. Food. Food. A dog should know better than to sleep at night. The men, too. The animals were friendly at first, but they soon learned we were not to be trusted. Now they hid, or moved about at night as the beavers do. When spotted out during the day, there have been reports of attacks. The natural creatures of this place hissed and clawed wildly at the men, drawing blood in defense of themselves and their home. The island feels colder now. Hunger does feel familiar, and not just because I've been hungry, truly hungry, before. It feels like heartbreak, empty, scraping the walls of my belly, unfulfilled, a kind of hopelessness. Two beavers, a pair, romantic. Miss Claire has started eating grass. Often, to assuage heartbreak, we cram our gullets with any number of things in an attempt to trick our cravings, to mask the hunger. Miss Claire stuffs her long apron into her mouth and chokes. But what are we to do when there is simply nothing, nothing to satisfy our appetites? When the content consumed has no true value, we're often left sicker than we began. Miss Claire's wine grew as well as widened. I was out doing the washing midday, and I heard it. Her wail flew across the island like one of the long-necked white birds we'd grown accustomed to here, sweeping low over us all, knocking the breath out of me. It had been a fortnight since she'd given in to silence, but now it seemed she'd been saving her sorrows up, rationing her pain, allowing herself only to feel a sampling of it daily, but now she'd succumbed, and as she indulged, it consumed her. She threw herself down to the rocks below, where only the birds could pick at her. Last I looked, there was still a scrap of her apron still latched on. The white flag of surrender. The way it blows makes me shiver. We try to distract ourselves from wanting. Perhaps there is something else we could want instead. A Mistress Forrest busies herself with home remedies, making herself up with rouge made from berries, the ones unfit for eating, of course. The other women have become expert in intricate hair braiding. The younger men challenge each other to climb highest tree after highest tree. The older men tell tales of journeys past, and when they've reached the far side of their cups of ale, they confess to seeing others here before us. I knew it. We all know to forget. How long does it take to build a beaver dam? A drought comes, or rather has come. No rain one day or the next. Suddenly we're paying attention. A month comes and goes. The colony is in a daze. 4.5 months soaked at sea. A distant memory. All of the crops planted upon our arrival are decimated by lack of rain. Even the once marshy peninsula is now mostly dry. Then come rumors of foul drinking water coming from the estuary. Now, what water we do have, we must double and triple boil. The beavers drown in their pond. Now a poison puddle, I... I pause. I rest. Above me is a bird's nest. So intricate. Sticks, leaves, moss, woven together into a kind of home. A fortress, I suppose. Shall I do it battle? Shall I hurl rocks at it? Will it feed me for today? Oh, day. The tiniest of eggs. A sip of yolk. Would the effort truly be worth it? Oh, the corners of my mouth crack. The drought wasn't their fault. Our poor planning wasn't either. I hoped that no one else would spy their tree-lined dwelling. Upon my return home, Master Forest greets me with a whistle of a hello. He knows that fall will soon become winter and has begun reinforcing our timber walls with stone. He pecks at it bit by bit with his beak. You can tell the seasons are changing because he's begun to molt. I boil the water. I watch it bubble and pop. I wonder what poison there really is in its drops. I imagine it bubbling in my belly, poisoning my insides. And then suddenly, I can hear it. Tap, tap, tapping. Then I shake my head. I put my hands on my stomach. It's outside! Rain! Everybody seems to run outdoors, mouths wide open. It drops, drops, drops into my mouth. My mouth so wide I could swallow the sky. Rain pinging off the sides of my throat, the floor of my belly, the biggest basin I can find. It pours! Rain streams into my eyes, my ears, my nose, and my mouth. I choke on my own thirst. The feast is the biggest I've ever laid eyes on. Is it a birthday or a wedding? A burial and a birth? They have been preparing for days and weeks ahead of time. Oh, it is beautifully laid out with flowers and greenery and wreaths of all kinds. I am ready, ready to stuff myself to bursting. Roast pig, beef stew, soups and curries of all varieties. Goat, cod, caribou, elk, oh, 30 kettles brewing, 20 lambs cooking, bowl after bowl filled full up, oh, all the juice, all the flavor, spoons raised, voices singing, let's gulping, sucking. Oh, fill me up! Fill me up! Oh, the sun shines extra brightly this day. And my mouth waters. I wake in a cold sweat, and a young woman, perhaps just a touch younger than me, is at my side, holding a cold cloth to my brow.
I'm Jane. I arrived 2 days ago on the third ship. We were lucky enough to make it before this rain turns to snow. Not sure how the other two ships will fare. And you seem to have been lucky enough to have been granted a few days' rest. I dare say the weather continues to change quickly out there. Not much of an autumn, I should think. We'll be icy in our beds soon enough. So you sleep tight. I'll wake you tomorrow.
As she turned to take her candle and go, there was no mistaking it. Miss Jane was pregnant.
Back to work. Back to life.
The new world forged ahead. Despite the influx from the third ship, there were now less people than had originally arrived. The drought took some. The sickening took many. And then there were those who couldn't last the ship's voyage. Old age, dampness, and of course, starvation. Day after day now, we were wearing what black we had. The morning bell rang on end. 9 rings for a man, 3 for a child, and 6 for a woman. We were supposed to feast after a funeral to appease the spirits, but the spirits remained dissatisfied. Like a bundle of shadows huddled together, Mistress Forrest and I watched the small crowd move on and go their ways, the sun just starting to set. Master Douglas's mouth holds a blade of grass. Oral fixation. Most had now come to keep a blade of grass between their lips.
What a waste! They just threw her over right quick with all that earth, all that cheap meat, throat tissue, brain, a lot of good she could have been put to. It's just like cattle or pork, cut her up proper, there'd be no disrespect.
You can't be serious. She's a person.
She's a woman, was a woman. And you had best watch your tongue.
Why? Will you cut it out? Fry it up real nice for yourself?
I just might.
You are an animal.
Come along, Anne.
We hurry away from Master Douglas. I never seen anyone salivating over a dead body before. Mistress Forrest was right. He did look like an animal. But rabid. His eyes were dead focused. But his hide was electric, ready to pounce. He was ravenous. How could he even think of eating her?
He's hysteric. The lack of food's got to people's heads. You stay away from him. You hear me? He's not to be trusted like this.
Yes. Yes, Mistress Forrest.
Now come along. We've got to shake out the cabin before Master's back.
On the walk home, the frost freezes my cheeks. I rub them to get the blood moving. I imagine what it would be like to eat a human cheek. I imagine Master Douglas's gnarly teeth coming for my face like he's about to take a bite out of a crab apple. The image lives in my mind still.
You know, if one were to feast on human flesh, I imagine it would be far easier to consume a spineless creature like Master Douglas.
I smile and feel as though I should laugh. but can't quite. Now come along. There's got to be something at home to fill us up. Something, right? She looks to me for comfort, but I fear my eyes are as empty as my insides. Oh, it is freezing now at night. And I know people are using each other's bodies for warmth, sleeping as close as possible. Simple necessity for some, sure, but for others, the height of their heat's flames is a little higher. In this icy, cold, white night, shrieks of passion pierce the sky, sometimes silly sounding, sometimes confounding, sometimes enviable. I wish their screams would heat this island up and warm us all. Imagine their screams cutting open the sun and casting down some relief. Imagine the entire island on fire. All the trees, all the shadows burning. Would I feel better? Just because you need food doesn't mean you don't need other things. Walking the perimeter of the island is my escape. I thought for so long that this new world would be it. But now it seemed there would always be need for somewhere else. It wasn't that I thought of a specific place as I made my way along the rocky shore and through the long grass. Simply elsewhere. The water's dark and deep. I stare into it. It takes my mind from me. My body rooted hard and fast to the earth. But myself. Myself. Anywhere. Everywhere else! You're not supposed to move. Gathering firewood. Cutting logs. Setting traps. All means more energy. More food. So just sit still. Despite the warnings, Jane joins me on my walks. She's just under 4 months along. It happened on the journey, she tells me. Together, we dissect what we see happening around us. Huge men now wear their clothes like storm-drenched sails, clinging to their masts. See how they sway from side to side, just to keep upright? Jane is married. Her master is much older than she, but she doesn't seem to mind. She loves him. We spend our days together. We find the best and safest sea cave and claim it our own. Make crafts, crowns, invent folklore, fairies, and before winter makes itself permanently at home, we build a sand castle. It is more mud and sticks than sand. But it is all part of the pretending. Pretending everything is fine. Our castle ends up a kind of mini fort, complete with barracks, chapel, and port. What about a graveyard? There have been rumors of two. The men have been keeping two. One with headstones, markers for show, and the other for the bodies, multiple per grave. A sacrilege! Mistress Forrest and I had gone to see for ourselves. Please, don't leave me alone in the dark. I'm sorry, I'm here. Have you had enough? Shall I lead us back? Don't you dare. I'm all the curiouser, but that doesn't mean I'm not frightened. The dead's at hand. Stay close. On the far side of the factory, we find a fresh grave and peer in. The younger man is face down, his right arm across the older man's chest, his hand on his heart. An intimate end. It's barbaric! That's Master William and young Tom. I'm sure neither fellow wanted this for himself. We've abandoned our burial customs. A body, face down, not properly shrouded. What have we come to? I think they look peaceful as that clear moon. But be wary, for it means frost soon. Now come along. I think we've had enough curiosity for one evening. Let's to bed. Although I'm sure my dreams will be full of young Tom and Master William and the cold to come. Let's pray that a warm bed and a mighty feast welcome them as they parted this world. Jane and I continue to play in our muddy little yard. Worms keep us company. So much brown. I think of meat stew. More like mud pie and dirt soup. If only make-believe were real. We use stones of slate as headstones. Jane puts a single flower petal on each grave. A whole flower would be too big. This public graveyard is all for show. The private graveyard is not for anyone to know. Graves wide and shallow, a graveyard made for the ones doing the digging. Wide so as to fit more than one body. Shallow means less effort required. The ground's hard now. There's no energy to dig the full 6 feet. The men doing the digging were quite likely digging their own final resting place. Graves wide enough to fit two or three comfortably.
Who would you want as your companion?
In my grave? What a question. Would there be passion? Would there be talking? There probably wouldn't be anything at all. Here. On this island, who would I take? Master and Mistress Forest? Would they want that? Me cuddled in the middle? I'm not their child. I wonder, would it be luxurious in a big old bed of rich dark earth on all sides? The wider the grave, the more room to breathe? Or would it be lonely in an extra large grave all by myself? Rolling around, banging into walls, no one to cushion the blow of the afterlife.
It's just a hole.
A dirty hole in the worm-filled earth.
Filthy.
No place for a nice girl.
Just me and mine.
Just me, myself, and I. Days pass. Our childish games run amok. Vote someone up. Vote someone to eat. Kiss, marry, kill. Stew, smoke, fry.
Eat the heart, gain the love. Eat the brain, gain the wisdom. Eat the lungs, gain the power of a warrior.
It's just a game. It's just a game. Was it just a game? I couldn't help but think we should be more democratic with the food we do have. The old, sick, and slow do suffer. It's survival of the quickest. Grab, 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 grab. What is sacred?
Who wouldn't you eat? And why?
My mother! If she were here. Although, she'd probably want me to. If it was a matter of my own life or death. She'd have to be dead already, though.
Rare. Medium rare. Medium well. Well, bloodier means juicier. Would go down easier.
Well done. Like an old leather boot. Tough and chewy. It would take forever to swallow. Chewing for days. Keeping them in our hearts and minds and mouths. Always. This new place meant so many new changes. Mistress Forrest struggles still. And of course, a new place means somewhere lost. A new place, a not so new place. A place. So much to miss.
It is hard to replant a flower tree.
Most of my days are spent seeing to Mistress Forrest, not just offering her tea, boiled water with a bit of bark, but also comfort and companionship. To be truthful, most days I'm grateful for it too. For her and for Jane. They are friendly, but there is a distance between them. One I suppose I have encouraged, rationing my friendships as we've done with our provisions. We must keep the men strong. Our system, men first, then women and children. Of course, it is hard to keep the food out of the mouths of those who prepare it. And there's power, too. And Master Forrest has it. So Mistress and I are privileged. Not many chores to do these days. Cooking really did take up a lot of my time. I go see Jane. We spend our days talking about food.
If we were to do it, meat in particular, really do it.
Jane craves the iron more than most. Her unborn baby girl scratches nailless at her abdomen. A baby girl because she's carrying high.
How do we know where to cut? How deep we could go?
What was safe?
What's safer? A sure death due to starvation? We've no choice.
You've always a choice.
Perhaps if the piece was so small, I could swallow it
without even knowing it.
A kind of unsavory medicine?
Just toss it back,
straight to the pit of my belly.
Just don't let it touch your teeth, thump your throat, or tickle your tongue.
We laughed, but not for too long.
We'd become like cottontails, eating grains, tiny berries, and grass. Our diet was flora. Our diet was fauna. Jane looked like she was becoming a rabbit, her back bent, hooked over her growing belly, her hands, quick but careful, clutching at anything that might be edible. She sits, watching, her dark eyes somehow bigger now, drinking it all in, on high alert. An owl cries, her ears shift forward. I share my trappings with her, her ears shift back. She's so soft, so delicate. Her hair, almost the color of snow, which has finally arrived. But we're all hard underneath. A skeleton of dangerous, tiny little bones. On our evening walk one night, Jane looks pale. She reaches out for the rocky surface before her, finds a seat and drops herself into it. She'd been so graceful and quiet before this, but carrying a child had made her heavy-footed and full of groans and moans and burps and blurts.
Are you all right?
I'm fine. I just need a minute. Excuse me. It's this baby that's making me a mess. Oh, there's hardly any food, and I feel her moving around. Oh, she's uneasy. Feels like she's gnawing at my stomach, sucking and slurping at anything she can. If there's no food in there, what is she going to eat? What's in there anyway? My liver? My kidney? Kidneys? She's having kidney pie, and I feel like my guts are being thumped. When she's down here, I have to pee every minute, and then she turns, and it feels like my heart is in my throat, and I'm gagged. And she turns, and turns, and...
Jane, you look green.
I'll be fine. I just need a... Minnie!
Jane throws up. I rub her back as she continues to vomit. She was right. There was hardly any food these days. The weather had condemned us to that. And with no sign of the fourth ship, food was scarce. But as a pregnant woman, Jane was eating more than most. Her master saw to that, sharing his rations with her. There were now two pregnant women in the camp. Carrying a child almost seemed worth it, just to get something proper to eat. As Jane heaved and wheezed, I couldn't help but stare into what she'd just retched up. She'd had some of the last corn, bright yellow, and some kind of sausage. There was brown in her bile. A sick pile of hash on the bright white ground. Jane calms herself and wipes her mouth with her skirt. I fantasize about a hot breakfast. I kick snow over her dinner and bite my lip to keep from crying. What a waste! Best get in now. I help Jane up. A good night's sleep should help. As Jane makes her way into her cabin, I wonder what it would be like to be consumed from the inside out. That was sort of what hunger felt like anyway, like your stomach was sucking itself in. Not all at once. Sometimes in parts I feel the pain under my heart, and then in the pit of my stomach. Imagine a baby growing in there. Nothing else to do but eat, I suppose. The trouble is, the hunger doesn't stop when you're born. It grows. The next day, Jane's on bed rest. I worry for her. I head out for a walk and bring Eddie, a faithful companion. The men used to keep the dogs tied up, what with the sick water, and to keep them from fighting over food. For one bully could mean three would starve. Eddie was the last one left. He was no bully, though. He was the smartest and the sweetest. Hunger has its own logic. Stumble across Mistress Forest and watch her make and set a turkey trap. It is impressive, if ineffectual. Not many turkeys out for a stroll this time of year. She insists on keeping busy, running her whole self ragged, body and mind. She wants its bone to crack, to make a wish. She's desperate for a merry thought. Eddie and I move on. There is a comfort to it, eating, the repetitive nature of it. How do you eat slowly when you are ravenous, knowing a single bite could likely make you ill? If you haven't eaten, how do you know how big of a bite you can take? How big of a bite you should take? The wind howls. Surely no turkeys today. Hunger is a kind of longing. The ponds are full of shadows. Frozen thunderstorms under glass. Someone's angry. Off one end of the island, I spy patience before ship. It is snow covered and frozen in the ice. It's too far out. No need for alarm. Frozen a good while now, it seems. A ship-shaped iceberg. We walk. We row. The remaining population, 90 now and dwindling, has come to only wear black, what black we have. The morning bell rang and rang until there was no one left to ring it. I would have thought the butcher to live the longest, what with first access to protein, but he succumbed to the sickness that came with the second ship. Or was it the third? Now, the meat the men did hunt had lost its smooth edges. The methods were maintained by memory, and no one could remember the same as anyone else. Then, we lost all meat. All the early animals, all the rats, all the mice, all the snakes, gone. All the sane creatures of this place had long since started hibernating. This winter was staying put. We walk, we roam. The frost bites, hungry for my ears, Eddie's tail. We step into the arms of a large fir and let it hold us for a while. Eddie's big brown eyes on me. I'm his master forest. His left eyebrow raises. Food? I pet him between his ears. Sorry, Eddie. No food today. As I scratch the fur behind his neck, I realize there is food here. Him. And me. When will this doggy snap? We are warned about keeping alone too long. One's mind can wander amidst the hunger pains. We're told to keep one another in line. Recognize the wildness in our eyes and the terror in our twitching cheeks. Tell a master. They would take care of it. But what the masters didn't realize was that the watchful eyes were watching a little too closely. The wildness in all our eyes.
You know, in some cultures, the eyeball is considered a delicacy.
How you cook it, how you eat it, suck, slurp, crunch. I wondered, would the color of the eye determine its taste? Blue, blueberries, water, green, long beans, melon, brown, chocolate, roast beef, dirt. This is not food meant to be consumed for pleasure. I choke on the stem of a bearberry. Inside, the shadow of a place, the shadow of a tree, a tall, spiky spruce, a shadow appears as a hole in the world, a puddle of darkness, a gap in the universe. But who or what do I see in that deep dark? A face? My own? Myself? 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 Word comes that a pregnant woman has been murdered. Her husband, so hungry, he cut her into pieces, salted her, and ate her up. It's not Jane. They put her body with the trash in the cellar. Not a proper burial. Not a burial at all. It's not Jane. The man is executed. Whisperings of jokes about punishment for not sharing. How dare he waste the placenta? It's not Jane. People go back to their business. The business of being hungry. I worry for Jane. And then, and then, and then, with more and more deaths, she's cold to the touch, but she's still warm inside. Her outer skin like jerky, her stomach sweetbread, a delicacy, no! There's nothing to be enjoyed here. She was our friend. Our friend. Our neighbor. Yes, our neighbor. Suddenly, everyone's a butcher. Many cuts, chop marks on her head made after she died. No one is a murderer here. What can we eat? Can we eat? We eat. My leather boots, too precious, I say. The skin is always the best part. Crispy, seasoned, oh, a skull, a shin bone. Many cuts, many saw marks, gouges made by the tip of a knife. I walk.
walk. I'm wrong. I walk. I'm wrong. I think I see another ship. Some hope. Master Douglas succumbs. Mistress Forrest is too far gone to comment. Master Forrest sits as still as a noble fir. Put sage in the fire to keep flies away. Thin strips of flesh are best when hanging meat to dry. Dead meat. Her blonde hair, almost white. You know, you can learn so much about a person from the contents of their stomach. From a high status family, from the southern coast, had not been here long. She died in her sleep, her baby in her belly. Eat the heart, gain the love, eat the brain, gain the wisdom, eat the lungs, gain the power of a warrior. Jane's chanting rings in my ears. Must I swallow it whole? You must, especially with parts like the baby toe and the earlobe. The earlobe? What power could an earlobe possibly have? Some people don't even have one. Exactly.
Started eating itself, his muscles detaching, his teeth falling out, his skin so thin, even a tender touch could tear it. At his end, his body shrunk, his lungs heaving and crackling, seemed to hang outside of his body. His once giant frame. Then his long arms wrapped himself up, curling in like a dormant bulb. I take a bite and I wait. Do I feel stronger? Do I feel different? Changed? Empowered? Do I feel anything? Prickling in my belly, but that's nerves. Nothing else? I wait. Died of a broken heart. Jane's master. Tastes like heartbreak. Sun is bright. Eddie's at my side. Or is he? The snow crunches beneath our my feet. The wind still, so quiet. No mistress forest, no master forest. All gone, alone. Hello? In this new world. Is it still new? These barracks blend into buildings I have seen before. These bushes feel familiar. This tree is my grandmother because her eyes crinkle the best of any here. And Eddie is my brother because he is the sweetest and the best to cuddle. I think I see a rabbit. Or is it? It's a small child. A girl. She's picking flowers. But it's winter. Or is it fall again? Summer still? No. She is. Picking through the underbrush for stones. Now she's running. Running as fast as she can, straight towards the sea cliff. And I think, can I imagine a future? And she runs by me. Candied fruits and berries affixed to the decorations in the church have long been eaten. There is no shame, or indeed there has been, but I've swallowed that up too. I walk. And I walk. I stare into the mouth of the estuary, where only tributaries meet. And I walk, walk, I walk the perimeter of this place, this old new world, this prison of possibilities. And I walk. And I walk. I'm here. I'm still here.
Yeah.